As I mentioned, my name is Case, and I will talk on smoothing your data with polynomial fitting, actually how to remove noise, and specifically with my maybe even biased signal processing glasses on. So just a very short slide with some background. I worked for a few years at several universities, did a PhD in Delft. I was in Stockholm for a while and also here in the hospital in Leiden. And basically the topic there was mainly audio and speech signal processing. Think of hearing aids, cochlear implants. Then I made a shift to industry. I worked at Philips Research for a while with all kinds of heart rate signals, optical, electrical signals. And now I work at Tone. Well, probably the Dutch people would know Tone, but just to see, we're in IoT and we provide this smart thermostat where you can also see, for example, your energy insight and all kinds of other IoT devices. Okay, so before we start, I actually have to confess something. So I just started working with Python 1 year. Maybe even to make it worse, I worked with MATLAB for 8 years. I hope you're easy with me, more easy than, this is for the insiders here. Good. I'm very happy that my shift to Tone was actually a very good excuse to start the shift to Python. I mean, you can imagine when you're already working with that for that long, and for example, also within a company, it's very difficult to shift the language, but this was the best excuse ever, so I'm very happy with it. And there are probably not a lot of MATLAB people in here, or maybe they are silent, but if you want to make the transition, please let me know. It's not that easy, actually. I mean, a lot of stuff is similar, but, let me know if you want to have more details on that. Okay, so about the motivation of this talk. Well, basically, today we're dealing with how to remove noise from your data. So this is a typical signal we have from our lab. It's a temperature signal, and as you can clearly see, there's some noise on top of it. This is a recording of around 1 hour. And, well, at the end of this talk, we will end up with these types of signals where you actually have a clean estimate of the signal. And today I'm going to particularly focus on removing this noise with by fitting polynomials. So, yeah, and as I mentioned before, I will do this with my signal processing glasses on. I noticed that the field of signal processing is typically sort of historically related with electrical engineering. Actually, I also have a computer science background, but during my PhD, I shifted more towards electrical engineering. And I see a lot of around me with data science problems that I think, like, hey, maybe you can apply some signal processing there. So hopefully it will give some insight today. I also want to make clear that this particular problem of polynomial fitting, I mean, it may not be the best way to remove noise from your data. But I choose this particular example because I think it's a typical time domain approach. And people later on realized that you actually also can interpret it from a frequency domain perspective. And that gives really interesting insights on how to set up your filter. So just this third item, today's topic is not necessarily on how to optimally remove noise from your signal, but more how to interpret your filters in the frequency domain. This polynomial fitting is actually called Savitsky-Golay filtering. And those two persons in the 60s found out that this very old method can be interpreted in the frequency domain. Okay, let's start with the beginning. We have some data, some points observed, and we want to fit some kind of degree polynomial to it. So in the NumPy package, well, probably a lot of you maybe already used it. There's this function called polyfit. You can give your data your x and your y points, and you can set the polynomial degree there. And with the function polyval, you can actually evaluate the polynom. Well, just some examples. Here we have 5 data points. And this is a first degree polynomial fit, nothing fancy. Second order, third, actually I skipped the third order, as you can see. I went straight to the fourth order. Well, this is the basics where it starts, right? How to fit your data with such a polynomial. Well, as was already mentioned in, I think, a lot of talks today, typically you don't have a nice clean observation of your signal, but it's corrupted by noise. So we don't have access to y, but we actually only have access to y plus some kind of epsilon. Now, the nice thing about this polynomial smoothing is that you can actually make an estimate of the underlying clean signal. So here on the right, I have an example. So this is, of course, a lab example where I generated y myself. But the polynomial was fitted only to y plus epsilon. And you can see that the green line, sort of nicely, is on top of the blue line. So somehow, magically, in this way, you got rid of the noise. So one issue with this polynomial fitting approach is that, I mean, at a certain point, you have very long signals, right? And you need higher polynomial degrees to actually estimate this underlying clean signal. Now, here, for example, we have this temperature signal again, which was around 1 hour. Well, here I already needed a 10th degree fit to make it nice. And, well, you can already see that it's having problems here. And the problem is also, you run into numerical problems if you take high degrees. I think at my PC, if you start fitting with 11 or 12 degrees, you already get kinds of numerical errors, and it will not give a solution. So there's actually an alternative approach here, and that's by chopping your signal up into short time segments, and you fit a polynomial to a local short time segment. And there the assumption is that you can make a better fit with a low degree polynomial. Well, let's have a look at that in the next slide. So this short time window here is indicated by this orange line, actually the horizontal line. And if you combine the x and y axis in this case, this orange line is actually the fitted polynomial. I think in this particular case, I used a third degree. And then you evaluate it at the center position. That's the green point. Well, subsequently, you shift your window, few samples, and you apply the same procedure, right? So you again fit the polynomial to a new subset of functions, and again, you evaluate the new green sample. Now, you could do that a few times after each other, and you see you still obtain a nice, smooth signal, and you got rid of your noise. So this is one way to overcome this problem by assuming that the signal locally can be estimated with a low-degree polynomial. So I wrote a function myself, which is actually doing that. It's called polyfitwindow. At the end of the presentation, I will give a link to the location of the code. And you can actually do this yourself. Well, actually, the good news is that in the next slide, I will give an alternative that you actually don't even need this function. So it's only here for demonstration purposes. Good. So here's a result of this same signal. So we first tried to fit this 10th order polynomial. The result was not good. So now I have a sliding window of around 100 seconds. And within this 100 second temperature signal, I fit a third order degree polynomial. And I evaluate it exactly in the center of the window. Well, you can see that the sensor noise in this case is nicely removed. So one issue with this approach is that this polynomial has quite some free parameters, right? It has the degree. You have to choose the degree. You have the window length. You could also vary the position where you evaluate the polynomial. And I mean, this looks nice, but I just tweaked it a bit until it looked nice. And actually, I don't like that approach. I would like to have some more intuition of what is actually going on. And am I certain that I'm only removing noise and not distorting the signal? Well, as already mentioned, in the 60s, Savitsky and Golay, they actually found out that this sliding window approach can actually be interpreted as a so-called linear time invariant system. And that facilitates frequency domain interpretation. And I will show by evaluating this in the frequency domain, you have a much better insight on what is actually the effect of these changing these parameters, like the degree of the polynomial. So before going to explain it, we need some basic theory, right? I will not go into details, but we need three basic ingredients before I can explain how to evaluate this method in the frequency domain. So first of all, we need the Fourier transform. I need to say something about linear time invariance. And those two things come together eventually in so-called convolution theorem. And then we can start analyzing our polynomial filters in the frequency domain. So this is actually my favorite XKCD comic, where you can see that apparently somebody accidentally took the Fourier transform of my cat. Of his cat, her cat, yeah. Actually, still when I have the time, I would love to actually take the inverse Fourier transform of that contour to see if we can get the cat back, but maybe for next PyData conference. Okay, some basics about Fourier transform. Well, I can imagine maybe a lot of people, this is very common knowledge, so, well, just stay with me. The basic concept here is that if you apply a Fourier transform to a signal, it will be decomposed into a sum of sinusoidal components. Actually, these is a sum of complex exponentials, but let's assume now we have a sum of sinusoidal components. So the Fourier transform is inside the NumPy package. There's actually a complete package which is called FFT. And well, one of the functions is the FFT itself, which stands for fast Fourier transform. And by applying that, you can decompose this particular signal into the frequency domain. So in this particular case, I have a signal which is a sum of two sinusoids. And if you look carefully, you can see there's one low frequency component around 2 hertz with an amplitude of 0.2. And you can see that in the Fourier domain, you can nicely see the 0.2 amplitude here located to that peak. So we have a high frequency component, which is around 20 hertz. And that's actually here with an amplitude of 1. So you can see from this frequency domain interpretation, you can nicely see which frequencies are present in the signal. Oh yeah, and for people who are wondering, this is Joseph Fourier, which is, of course, the founder of the Fourier transform. Okay, so I just explained the Fourier transform. The next part, which is very important, is a so-called linear time invariant system. So as I mentioned, it turns out that the sliding window approach, this polynomial smoothing, is a linear time invariant system. So what does that mean? Let's say that I denote this particular system with the Galligraphic T here. And you have some input signal X and some output signal Y. So linearity basically means, it's also called the superposition principle, is that we have a sum of two scaled signals and you apply your filter to that. That would be exactly the same as applying your filter to the two signals independent and summing the outputs. If that's the case, then it fulfills the linearity property. Time invariance means that if you delay the input signal, it would also be the same as only delaying the output signal. And that's what we have here. Well, we don't have to go into much detail here, but if these two properties are the case, it will give us a lot of mathematical advantages we can work with. To come back to the Savitsky-Golay filter, if you're really interested in that, I would definitely recommend this paper by Ronald Shaver, What is a Savitsky-Golay filter? It's written in a nice, easy way. Actually, 1 month ago, I was at a very big signal processing conference, and this guy received a Best Paper Award for this particular paper. I would definitely recommend to read it. So, to come back to a linear time invariant system, any LTI system can be fully described by its impulse response. So one nice example of LTI systems are actually acoustics, as in audio, right? So if you have the acoustics, for example, of a church, that particular reverb can be very well be described as an LTI system. And that's exactly what this person is doing here. So he has a balloon there, which is actually his impulse, and he pops the balloon and he records the tail of the reverb. That's called the impulse response. So if you recorded that and you have it at your computer at home, you can actually apply that to your dry signals, and it will sound as if the particular sound is played back in that environment. So the LTI assumption is very valid for acoustics. And if I mention apply an impulse response to your signal, you have to do that with a so-called convolution. Well, I have to be honest, I heard the convolution already a lot of times today. But it's really a different context than I'm working in. But I assume that they mean the same thing. But maybe it's good if somebody also helps me with that after the talk, if we're talking about deep convolutive networks. So this is the convolution operator. And this H is our impulse response. Good. So in applying a convolution is available in the signal module in the SciPy package, and that can be done like this. So if you have your impulse response, you can convolve your signal and, well, it is filtered. So now let's go back to these Savitsky-Golay filters or this polynomial smoothing. These are the impulse responses of such a polynomial fitting approach. And I use several polynomial degrees. This is degree one, which is actually very interesting because it's just a straight line. And this is the degree 3, 5, 7. Well, maybe with some imagination you can relate the order to it of the polynomial, but still it doesn't give so much insight, right? Looking at these impulse responses and this complicated convolution sum. So one final thing, if you want to have the impulse response of a Savitsky-Golay filter, it's also in the signal module, in the SciPy package, and this is the way how you can get them. So basically, having this impulse response and applying it with this convolution will give you exactly the same result as I just showed with this sliding window approach. So I explained Fourier transform, I explained linear time invariance. Now we can go to the convolution theorem, which is actually a very important theorem. It states that a convolution in the time domain is equal to a pointwise multiplication in the frequency domain. And this is very helpful because this convolution of this signal and this signal is very difficult to interpret. But if we suddenly go to the frequency domain, so we still have our sum of our two sinusoids, right? The 2 hertz and the 20 hertz. And this is actually the frequency response of such a polynomial smoother. And what do we see here? If we pointwise multiply them, all the frequencies here are preserved. The low frequencies and the high frequencies are actually attenuated. Well, in signal processing, we have a very simple word for that. We call that a low-pass filter. So your polynomial smoothing is just a low-pass filter where the cutoff frequency depends on your variables. So if you pointwise multiply them, you will completely remove the high frequency sinusoid. And if you look in the time domain, you indeed see that the low frequency component is still there, but the high component is completely gone. Good. So apparently it's a low pass filter, this polynomial smoothing. So what happens if we start tweaking with the polynomial degree? So here I have some examples. So just as a refresher, here we have the polynomial description. The window length is fixed, but now we change the polynomial degree. And you can see if you increase the polynomial degree, you actually increase the cutoff frequency of your low-pass filter. So if it destroys your low-frequency signal too much, you could increase the polynomial degree. If you want more high frequencies to be attenuated, you could decrease the polynomial degree. And maybe it's also good to add that if you look at the slope of the filters, they're pretty much similar, right? They pretty much have similar steepness. So the second parameter besides the degree of the polynomial was actually the length of the window. Let's call it n. We see a similar effect. If you increase the length of the polynomial smoother of the window, you will decrease the cutoff frequency. So again, we have a low-pass filter with a varying cutoff frequency, which depends on the window length. But what is interesting is to note is that now it also affects the slope. So if you make it less, if you increase the cutoff frequency, you will also have a more less steep slope. And so it's not the same by changing this parameter or this parameter. Good. So that was some theory. Let's go back to the real world where we actually apply this. So with our smart thermostat, as I mentioned, you can see your power consumption. And that's based on some kind of electricity meter, which is there in every house. So a lot of people in the Netherlands have smart meters, but there are still also some old analog meters like this. And as you can see carefully, there's a small disc rotating here, and it has a small spot on it. And with this particular meter module, you can actually read out that particular spot. So based on the speed of this spinning disc, it means that you're using more energy when it's rotating faster. So just a very simple example. Our meter module has an LED. It shines, so this is a top view. It shines some light on this rotating disc. And every time this spot, which has a different color, comes by, more light is absorbed. And we actually have less reflected light. So here you can see two rotations, and this pulse corresponds to the first time it passes by, and this is the second time. And this pulse interval is related to how much energy you're consuming. So we need some kind of algorithm. I mean, it looks very easy, right, from here, which detects this pulse. So we have a student working on this. And actually, our challenge is that we have this meter module. In other countries, this electricity meter can even be outside, in a place where there's no energy. There's no power socket. So we need to reduce the power of this LED as much as possible. So we have one student working on this. And he had we said, well, can you reduce the LED power? And he said, sure. And in this case, he just turned it off. So this is the signal you end up with when you only depend on environment or ambient light. Well, it looks very noisy, right? In fact, if you look at the sensor, it only has a dynamic resolution of 3 bits, because the sensor is hardly sensitive for this particular signal. So this is very challenging. So let's have a look in the frequency domain for this particular signal. So this is the signal we're looking at. So we see a few things. First of all, this low frequency signal here, that's actually the pulse. I mean, we know beforehand a bit the pulse interval we should look at. And the second thing we see in this picture is this. There's a lot of noise. And that's, of course, because of this low dynamic resolution of our bits. There's a lot of quantization noise. There's a lot of white noise. And this is spread all over the spectrum. So the third thing we see, and that's actually also very interesting, we have some kind of ambient light at 50 hertz. So you can imagine that in your closet where your electricity meter is, you also have other lights, and they also tend to have a certain frequency. Well, the nice thing is, if you go to the frequency domain, I mean, this is the ideal distortion you want to have. If it's a perfect sinusoid, because in the frequency domain, you can easily remove it. So here we have a Savitsky-Golay filter, and now it's actually quite easy to set up your parameters, right? Because now I just want to maintain the signals which are here, and I want to attenuate everything over here. I mean, looking at this, it is much easier to choose these variables. So let's have a look. This is the signal after applying the filter. So you can still, okay, there's still some ambient light. I didn't even mention that. There's still some stuff here. I don't have a clue what that is actually. Maybe it is some aliase or, well. So this looks very good in the frequency domain. Let's go back to the time domain. I thought it was a nice example. Maybe just have a look. We applied the filter, and we also need some magic for it. And voila, here we have the underlying pulse signal. So you can see that clearly all the noise is nicely removed. And the quantization noise is gone. And I think on first sight, it's not so clear that the signal is still there. But if you look at the eventual signal-to-noise ratio of this Savitsky-Golay filter signal, I think, looks promising. Okay. Now, to conclude. I explained something about polynomial filtering. And it turns out that it's actually an LTI system. And basically, it's a low-pass filter, where the settings, the free parameters have certain effects on the cutoff frequency and the slope of the filter. I just want to repeat again that, so the goal of today's talk was not necessarily to explain how to optimally remove noise, but just that a lot of methods have a frequency domain interpretation, and they really help to make decisions. And I think this polynomial fitting was a really nice example because I think it's originally designed as a time domain method, and just people later on realize like, hey, let's have a look what you're actually doing in the frequency domain. So all the plots I showed in this figure are generated with Python, and actually you can all regenerate them yourself by following the GitHub link. So there you can regenerate all the plots, so you also have access to these specific signals, and well, you can do your own thing. So that's the last thing. Actually our current student is almost finished and he's writing his thesis, so he's also a very good excuse for me to do nice signal processing theory stuff. So we're looking forward for a new student, and we're recruiting for a data scientist, machine learning engineer. Thank you.